Wonderful to see you all this morning. Happy Sunday. Whether it's your normal practice to be with us at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning, or whether you're visiting with us today, or whether you are watching online, we are delighted to have you with us. Welcome. Would like to remind you that you will find in front of you in your pews our friendship pad. We ask that you please make a note to let us know that you're here, especially if you're visiting today. We would love to know that you're here so we can reach out and welcome you and to answer any questions that you might have about St. John's. There's several messages I would like to share with you this morning. First of all, we would like to remind our children and their families that on September 12th, our children's ministry, the Grove Program, will be kicking off for the fall. It will be from 5 to 7 o'clock, and there will be an ice cream social and a bounce house. So that just sounds like a lot of fun. I'll come for the ice cream, but I'll let Reverend Douglas do the bouncing. But y'all please make a note of that. We'd also like to remind the families of our third graders that on September 19th, our third graders will be receiving their Bibles. If you have questions or if you need more information on that, we encourage you to contact Becca Muir or Amy Jernigan in the church office. We'd also like to bring to your attention that our senior adult council has postponed the Sunny Monday program that was scheduled for September 18th. It will now take place during the month of October. So please stay tuned to the bulletin for that upcoming information. Excuse me. We'd also like to bring to your attention that today in the bulletin, you will find an insert where our Jack Meeks Ramp Ministry is thanking those participants and the sponsors of our golf tournament this year. And we'd like to encourage you all, as you take a look at those sponsors, to please make your best effort to do business with those folks. And when you're there, be sure and thank them for their support of this wonderful and worthwhile ministry within our church. I'd like to remind our youth, our 7th through 12th graders, that there will be no youth meeting tonight. And we'd also like to remind you that our sister's Bible study will be beginning on September 16th from 9:30 to 11. All the women of our church are invited to be a part of that. They are going to be studying the book of Daniel. And if you have questions, please feel free to contact Millie Winston, as is noted in your bulletin this morning. And finally, please note that the church office will be closed tomorrow in observance of Labor Day. At this time, I invite you to rise as you're able for our opening hymn, hymn number 548. Please rise.
Oh, invite us to remain standing as we affirm our faith together with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Seated. At this time, I would like to invite our ushers to come forward for a time of tithes and offerings. Once the ushers are in place, we invite the crucifer to lead our children out to Children's Church.
Thank you. Gracious God, we do pray for your presence as we willingly give of ourselves that we follow you to be your disciples. If there was ever a time in our world where we needed faith and to be faithful disciples, it's now. Many of us have never experienced anything quite like what has been our lot over these past 2 years. With COVID and with earthquakes and wildfires, hurricanes, with all the stresses and pressures of life itself, as we think of our educators, our school board members, as we think of our students and our children, as we think of our loved ones and all those who are in helping professions, as we think of our nurses and our doctors and scientists and all those who are doing what they can to save us and protect us. As we continue to think about all those who gave of themselves for 20 years in Afghanistan, and particularly those families whose loved ones gave that last full measure of devotion. Oh Lord, we pray for your mercy. We pray that indeed we might be faithful disciples, whatever our lot, whether life deals with us fairly or whether it deals with us with cruelty. Help us, Lord, to trust in you, that you are King of kings and Lord of lords, one who loves us, who gave himself for us. You are the one who will sustain us through whatever is left of this pandemic, and we pray for its end. We pray that you might give us protection and that you might be with those who are suffering this day. Those who have suffered the loss of loved ones, not just through COVID, but through other circumstances. As we pray for those who are undergoing treatments and those recuperating from surgeries, who are anticipating procedures and tests, oh Lord, give us strength and give us confidence that come what may, we can put our faith and our trust in you. And help us, Lord, not to have a blind faith, but a faith that is filled with proof, a faith that is backed up by action. Help us to live our lives as those who believe. So, Lord, build up our faith and our trust today so that we might proclaim your hope to a world that is searching desperately for hope. For this is our prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples and has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Our scripture lesson this morning is found in the book of James, James chapter 2, verses 1 through 17. My brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, Here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, You stand there or sit on the floor by my feet. Have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles in just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, Do not commit adultery, also said, Do not murder. If you do not commit adultery but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. As I think about this Labor Day weekend and all of the different circumstances we are facing as a country and as a world, as individuals, I'm reminded of something from Greek mythology. The cruel king of Corinth was known as Sisyphus. Sisyphus. You might remember, if you studied any of that in Western civilization, you might remember that Sisyphus was condemned by the pantheon of Greek gods to perpetually, for eternity, to be pushing a heavy boulder up a steep hill. He would reach almost to the top of that steep hill, and that boulder would come rolling back down over him to the bottom of the hill, and Sisyphus, this cruel king of Corinth, would be relegated to having to push it back up the hill again, only for it to repeat itself over and over again. In many ways, that's how we all feel. Not just about our work, perhaps, on this Labor Day weekend, but about our lives in general with, here we go again with COVID. When's it going to end? What about hurricanes? And what about wildfires? What about earthquakes? What about murders and injustice? What about all of the mask wearing and everything else? There's so much. We're stuck, it seems, in this never-ending twilight zone of perpetuity. And we wonder, is it my lot to eternally have to push this boulder up the hill only for it to come down once again? It seems our lives are filled with three or four steps forward and seven or eight steps backward, like Sisyphus. So how do we deal with that? Well, we can begin with thinking about something I've been doing lately. I've been doing a little bit of car shopping, which is difficult nowadays because of chip shortages and all the rest. But I like my little sports car. But I am finding that I am of the age that it's a little more difficult to get in it and to get out of it. But as I've been around looking at vehicles, most all of them have wonderful safety features. And one of those safety features is one of those features that keeps you from going into the lane next to you without first putting on your turn signal. As a matter of fact, if you try to go over into that lane next to you, it tugs at you. It's a lane sensing device. It's generically called, I have found as I've looked at different vehicles, a lane departure mitigation system. A lane departure mitigation system. A lot of us need that. Not just to remind us to put on our turn signal, to stay in our lane. We want everybody to stay in their lane, figuratively and literally. But it reminds me, as I think of our country, as I think of our community, as I think of our individual lives and our world, we need to stay in God's lane. We need to do what's right. Jesus talked about this lane departure mitigation system in Matthew's gospel, the 7th chapter, verses 13 and 14, where he says, "Broad is the way that leads to destruction, but narrow is the way, the lane that leads to life." The book of James is one of the Bible's most important books about a lane departure mitigation system. It teaches over and over in the book of James how to live a practical Christian life and to find God helping us as we feel like Sisyphus with this never-ending boulder rolling back upon us and rolling over us. The book of James tells us about the straight path, the narrow way. It says, treat everybody alike. Don't have favoritism. Love your neighbor. Love God. But most of all, it clearly says, put your faith into action. Faith without works is dead. You can claim all day long that you have faith, but if you don't act like it, it's worthless. Football season is a good example of the difference between real faith and so-so faith. You can have a fair weather fan or you can have a die-hard fan. A fair weather fan is someone who loves their team when everything is going well. A die-hard fan is someone who loves their team whether they win or lose. And as a University of South Carolina graduate, I know that you have to be a die-hard fan because the weather is hardly ever fair. I remember very well some of our worst days. We've had quite a few of those with our football team. In 1998, Brad Scott was in his last year. The reason he was in his last year as our football coach, our head football coach, is because in 1998 he went 1-11 in 1998. Then he went to Clemson and did a lot better. I don't know what happened. But nevertheless, he lost his job, and then the next year we hired Lou Holtz as our head football coach. And in 1999, in his first year as our football coach, we went 0-11. We didn't win a game at all. I'm sure he wondered, why in the world did I ever come here? But we hung in there. We are masters at tailgating. And in 1999, when we went 0-11, we didn't say our usual, wait till next year, because it was 1999. We said, wait till next century, or wait till next millennium. And in many ways, we're still waiting, but we're used to it. And some of you, you know what I'm talking about. How many of you were Braves fans back when they weren't any good? In the pre-Ted Turner days, you know, when all they had was Warren Spahn or Hammer and Hank Aaron, or perhaps they had Phil Niekro, if you remember him, who threw a knuckleball that hardly anybody could hit. But other than those three, the Braves of my youth were pitiful. They were just pitiful. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Sydney Swans from Australia. The Sydney Swans were much like the Gamecocks and their pitifulness, much like the Braves of yesteryear. The Sydney Swans are a part of the Australian Football League, and I'm not talking about American football, and I'm not talking about soccer. I'm talking about rugby. They never won a game. Nobody ever filled the stands. Nobody came to the games hardly at all until they got this Ted Turner type who invested money to make sure they got better players. And then they started winning games and the fans started piling in and the stands were full of people. And in one of those games, a television cameraman panned the stands and there was a guy holding a sign that said, "I was here when nobody else was." I was here when nobody else was. Now that's a diehard fan. That's not a fair weather fan. That's a true disciple. One who has faith and action. Faith accompanied by action. And that's what we need. Especially in our world today, with all the problems and all the situations, we need to be all in. We need to be diehard fans for Jesus, not fair weather fans of Jesus. Some people come to Jesus because they think of him as the candy of life to kind of give them a little extra pep, a little bit of joy. Some people come to Jesus when they're stuck in a foxhole called illness and they think of Jesus as the medicine of life. But John's gospel calls Jesus the bread of life, one without whom we can't survive. We need Jesus to be our all in all, and we need our faith to be accompanied by action. I'm reminded of the story of these two crows that found themselves perched, one on one handle and one on the other handle of an old plow. You remember those old plows. You might have a tiller that's like that, has the two handles. Well, the two crows were sitting there, and they were beside an old country road in a very rural area. And a truck went by that was going to get its monthly groceries out in the middle of nowhere. And then later in the day, that truck came back by, and it hit a dip in the road. And because the bed of the truck was filled with all these groceries, a lot of those groceries bounced out when it hit that dip, including this foot and a half long tube of bologna. And so one of the crows flew over and started eating that bologna. It ate through the casing. And you know, it has that casing on there to help preserve the bologna. It's also salted pretty well. It's not that good for you if you have a problem with salt. And so that crow ate that salty bologna, had his fill, and went back and landed on one of the handles of that plow. The other crow flew over and stayed there a lot longer and ate more and more of the bologna. Even brought some of the bologna back with him and landed on the other handle of the plow. The first crow that did not eat as much found that the saltiness made him a bit thirsty, so he flew off to find some water to drink. The other crow that had eaten on that bologna, that saltiness for so long, it decided it wanted some water, so it took off and went about 4 feet and plopped. The moral of the story is nobody needs to fly off the handle if they're full of bologna. Nobody needs to fly off the handle if they're full of bologna. And I hate to say it, but when I think about our faith, if it's not accompanied by action, we're full of bologna. We're not the real deal. We're wannabes. We're like the crow that did not get very far. We're what we used to call backsliders. Some of you have heard that phrase about backsliding. That phrase backsliding has been around for quite some time. It was originated by John Bunyan and his Pilgrim's Progress, that wonderful English novel and allegory. John Bunyan, in that story, tells about the Christian pilgrimage. It's called Pilgrim's Progress, not Pilgrim's Regress, not Pilgrim's Egress, not Pilgrim's Digress. It's about Pilgrim's Progress. And he tells a story of two characters named Christian and Hopeful. And one day they are walking along, Christian and Hopeful, in their spiritual journey, their progress. And they talk about an old friend of theirs whose name is Temporary. Temporary, who had once been a part of their group, but who had fallen by the wayside, and in the words of John Bunyan, had backslid. And because of John Bunyan talking about someone who had backslid, that has crept into our Christian language to talk about anybody who was once on fire for the Lord, but then got caught up too much in other things and lost their fervor. We all need rededication. We all need to follow the straight and narrow. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. Narrow is the way that leads to life. We all need rededication. It reminds me of my first parish. I had three little churches in Chesterfield County, South Carolina. One of those churches had lost its roll book. And it was an old church, an old church. And finally, as we were moving things into the parsonage, I went up in the attic storing things, and I saw over in the corner a box, and in that box, as I went to it, crawled over there, there was the church's roll book. And I opened it up, and I noticed some of the similar and familiar family names that I'd already met, being their new preacher. And then I saw must have been their grandparents, or maybe even great-grandparents, family members somewhere along the line. And it had initials, abbreviations, beside every name. There was CT for Certificate of Transfer, OD for Other Denomination, there was PF for profession of faith. It was talking about their church membership and so forth. But then I saw an abbreviation that struck me as odd. I'd never seen it before. F-B-P-O. I had no clue. So I went to the oldest person I could find in the congregation. I said, "Can you explain to me what is an F-B-P-O? Member of the church?" And they thought to themselves and said, "Oh, that stands for burial purposes only." The church had a cemetery, and if you weren't a member of the church, you know, the cemetery was shrinking as it was filling up because it was so old. And so they had a lot of people who were members of the church just for burial purposes only. Now, I would not say that that's a diehard fan. I'd say that is a fair weather fan. As the saying goes about whether something is good or not, the proof is in the pudding. The proof's in the pudding. You know, people can claim that they are a good cook, but the proof is in how it tastes, right? The proof's in the pudding, or their claim isn't true. They can talk big. We can talk big as, "Oh, I'm a Christian. I believe in Jesus." But the proof's in the pudding. And according to the book of James, the proof is in how we back up our faith with action. With action. And oh, we need faith now, perhaps more than any time in our lifetimes. These are the times, as the saying goes, that try men's souls. Between Afghanistan and COVID and natural calamities and sickness and death and all the other just usual things that come our way, we need faith now more than ever. But give me a break. When I think about the proof being in the pudding, I think our pudding is lacking a little bit in terms of taste. For instance, how many of you heard what happened at Harvard University last week? Now, I know Harvard is a wonderful Ivy League school. It's one of the most prestigious schools, not only in the United States, but in the world. But do you know, or do you remember, that Harvard University was founded as a place to train preachers? As a matter of fact, it gets its name, Harvard, from Reverend John Harvard. It was founded in 1638 to train preachers. But you want to talk about backsliding? This past week, who did they name as their chaplain to be the director of their spiritual life department for the whole university? An atheist. Now give me a break. How in the world, in our day and age, when we need faith now more than ever to deal with all that we've got to deal with, would you name someone who officially claims that they have no faith? And you're going to make them the chaplain? The proof's not in that pudding to me. Let me put it another way, in a way that some of you Southerners in particular might understand. Let me talk about possums for a second. Now, I'm not talking about opossums, apostrophe possums. I'm talking about just plain old possums. I learned more about possums at John C. Campbell Folk School than you can imagine. I don't know if you've heard of John C. Campbell Folk School. It's located between Franklin and Murphy, North Carolina. It's in a little village. It's not even big enough to be a village. It's not even a hamlet. It's located in Brasstown, North Carolina. I mean, all kind of fancy people spend all kind of money to go and stay at John C. Campbell to learn how to do fabric arts and pottery and glassworks and blacksmithing. I mean, you name it. It's a wonderful place. They got in a little bit of trouble, however, with one of the locals who owns the little grocery store that includes the little post office, and I'm talking little post office in Brasstown. Well, I decided, since I wasn't one of those highfalutin people paying all the money and everything else, I'd go down and meet the fellow at the little store in Brasstown. So I went down and talked to him. I said, "What is Brasstown famous for?" And he said, "Besides those rich people up there at John C. Campbell, what we're mainly famous for is our possum drop." And I'm like, "Do what?" And he said, "Yeah, on New Year's Eve, you know, in Times Square, they drop that ball, that crystal ball, to bring in the new year. Here we do a possum drop." Now, I'm going to tell you, all those folks up at that school, they think we are cruel to animals, and they want us to stop, and now they're wanting us to put a fake possum in there, but I'm going to tell you, what we do with that possum drop, the possum loves it more than anybody. Because we feed that possum almost for a whole year. We fatten up that possum like you wouldn't believe. We put him up in a basket, hoist him up to the top of a tall pole, and so we bring in the new year by lowering the possum. We don't drop the possum. But if we have to, we'll get us a fake possum and do it. I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, you know about possums, don't you?" I said, "Well, not a whole lot." And so he proceeded to tell me, he said, "You know, possums are the oldest mammal in the world. Possums, according to the fossil record, are the oldest mammal in the world." And he said, "That's unusual because possums are not exactly hardy animals. They're slow, roadkill. They don't have hardly any natural defenses. But the reason they survive," the man went on to tell me, "is they'll eat almost anything. They'll eat almost anything. Secondly, they're pretty much immune to most common diseases among animals. They even have a built-in mechanism by which they are immune to snake venom." But he said, "Best of all, to help a possum survive, is that they can play dead. I mean, they can go into a semi-comatose state for up to 6 hours. And other animals, predators that are trying to get to the possum, they think that the possum is dead, and they won't eat a dead animal. They would rather take down a live animal and so forth. But they think the possum is dead, and so they sniff around, and the possum's not moving for up to 6 hours, and so they go on their merry way, and when they go on their merry way, that possum wakes up and goes on its slow, merry way." Now, I thought about that. There are a lot of us as Christians who've been playing possum. We're in a semi-comatose state in terms of our faith. I mean, really. You know, when you think about it, when a Southerner says somebody's playing possum, we mean that they're playing dumb. We're playing that they're pretending they're pretending not to understand to keep them from doing anything about anything. They're pretending to misunderstand so they don't have to do any work. And as according to the book of James, faith without works is dead. Faith without being accompanied by action is dead. How many of us have been playing possum about our faith in a day and age when we need faith now more than ever? It's kind of like the story of the fellow who fell out in church. You might not call it falling out in church, but that's the way I was raised. And people fall out in church. I mean, they might have a little spell. They might faint. They might have a little arrhythmia or something else. But this fellow fell out in church, and they called EMS, and they hauled off six people before they got to the right person. That's playing possum. Stop it. Let's don't play possum anymore. The good Lord knows we need faith. And He has given us faith through Jesus Christ. So that no matter what happens to us, no matter how much we feel like Sisyphus with our jobs and with COVID and with everything else, and we just keep pushing that boulder to the top of the hill only for it to roll back down over us one more time and over again. Let me tell you, your cure, according to James and according to all that we believe, your cure for feeling like every time you go forward, you end up taking more steps backwards. Your cure, my cure, is faith and putting it into action. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we do pray that you will help us to have a faith that's not fake. We want people to know that the proof is in the pudding of our faith, that it's real, that we're not playing possum. We need you, Lord. And so we come to you. You know what we're worried about. You know what's on our hearts and minds. You know we're scared. We're afraid. We pray, Lord, that you will deliver us from fear and help us to claim faith over fear. Help us, Lord Jesus, to not leave this place today without declaring that we believe in you and that we're going to promise to act like it. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our hymn is number 581, Lord, whose love through humble service. I invite you to stand as you're able. may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, His Son, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, so that indeed we might be more than conquerors through Him who has given His life for us, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.